"What would you like to be?" people sometimes say, "if you came back to Earth as an animal?" Well, the answer I give depends, I suppose, on the company. If it's a bit racy, I dare say my mind would range over a number of mammals remarkable for the extravagance of their reproductive techniques. But in more sober company, I usually find a safer answer. A sloth, I say. And why? Because it spends most of its time hanging upside down from a branch in the tropical rainforest, dozing. The sloth really is not only one of the laziest, but one of the strangest of mammals. It spends most of its life asleep, but even when it's awake, it only moves very slowly. No matter what the danger or the emergency, it is incapable of speed. There are two main kinds, defined by the number of toes that they have on their front legs. It's the three-toed, which has really slothful habits, and the one that interests me most. You're not likely to have seen it in zoos, for unlike the two-toed, which will eat all kinds of vegetables, the three-toed is really picky and will only accept leaves and fruits of a few particular kinds, which few zoos can supply. And in any case, it doesn't make an exactly dazzling exhibit, since it spends most of its time in slumber. It's about the size of a small, slim, upside-down goat, if you can imagine such a thing. It's covered in a shaggy coat of coarse, untidy hair, blotched in grey, cream and brown. The hair on its head is combed forward into a fringe. That on its body is parted down the middle of its belly, with the hair running down its flanks towards its spine, so that as it hangs upside down, the tropical rain, which it has to endure for several hours every day, does much the same. The thick coat is itself a home for an abundant population of other creatures. There are moths of a species that occurs nowhere else, and a particular kind of beetle. The hairs themselves have grooves down them, in which grows a special species of green alga. When these skins and skeletons of this extraordinary topsy-turvy beast reached Europe, artists, given the task of illustrating the species in natural history encyclopedias, showed it standing upright on its four thin rod-like legs, even though the hooks on its feet and the fur on its body all pointed very obviously in what you might call the wrong way. After all, the artists must have said to themselves, it would be too absurd to show it as an animal that spent all its life upside down. Because the sloth moves extremely slowly, there is little difficulty in catching one once you've spotted it, which is not easy because huddled in the crook of a branch or hanging beneath it, it looks like a bundle of dead leaves. The first one I ever encountered in a forest in what was then British Guiana and is now Guyana was pointed out to me by one of the forest-living Akawayo people in whose village we were staying. The tree wasn't difficult to climb. I was younger and nimbler in those days, and I was soon sitting astride a branch alongside it. The sloth looked at me amiably from beneath its fringe with a distant but benign smile. I was there making natural history films, and I thought I'd move the sloth to a branch where it would be easier to film. So I hauled up a liana that dangled nearby and had no problem in transferring the sloth's legs onto it one by one so that eventually I was able to lower it to the ground. We then took it back to the village and put it in an isolated tree just outside our hut, the leaves of which were to the sloth's taste. There was little chance that it would stray because sloths on the ground are virtually helpless. Its legs are little more than hangers and only have slim ribbon-like muscles that are just about strong enough to enable it to transfer its grip from one branch to another, but quite incapable of supporting it standing upright. So, on the ground, the sloth lies on its stomach and waves its legs around with a sort of vague swimming motion and just about succeeds in crawling very slowly forward, which it clearly doesn't like, because quite apart from the awkwardness of it all, it's very vulnerable to attack from ground predators such as jaguar. The following morning, I went out to look for it as it hung from its branch and saw, to my delight, a tiny, bedraggled baby sloth crawling very slowly from between its mother's hind legs and out onto her belly. One of the Akawaya women in the village told me a story about baby sloths. A pair of them, twins I suppose, were sitting on their mother's stomach, complaining that they were very hungry. Their mother craned her head forward and said, "Clamber onto that branch, children, and I'll go off and find some leaves for you. But you must promise that you won't stray from this spot, so that I'll be able to find you again." The babies promised, and away she went. A day passed, and then another. The babies got more and more hungry, until eventually, on the fifth day, one of the babies whispered to the other, "Why don't we go and look for some leaves ourselves?" Whereupon their mother's voice came from the leaves nearby. "I warned you," she said. "If you don't stay where you are, I won't go." In reality, though, there's not much whispering that goes on among sloths. They're only capable of a faint bronchial wheeze and an occasional whistle. These sounds are probably only made to deter a predator, and certainly not to communicate with one another, for sloths are virtually stone deaf. It's said that an enthusiastic zoologist investigating the hearing ability of sloths discharged his gun close to one. It slowly raised its head, blinked at the scientist, and then went back to sleep. Their eyesight is not much good either. In fact, the only sense that seems at all acute is their sense of smell, and it's that that they use to select their favourite leaves and fruit. So how do these purblind, half-deaf creatures find one another up in the branches when breeding time comes round? Well, it seems to be connected to their rate of digestion. That, like everything else, is extraordinarily slow. You might imagine that they would defecate with careless abandon, as they just hang there 50 feet up in the forest and allow their dung to fall to the ground. But not a bit of it. When the time approaches, a sloth sets off on what may be quite a long journey to a special tree in its territory. It slowly clambers downwards until it reaches the ground, where at the bottom of this tree there is a big pile of sloth dung, to which all the sloths in the area have contributed. Sloths have a communal loo. And there it hangs within a foot or so of the ground beside the great smelly pyramid while it adds its own contribution. Perhaps the midden is the one and only conspicuous beacon in the sloth's dim and silent world, the only place where there's a reasonable chance of getting close to another sloth and to know that you're doing so. If that's the case, then one would expect that sloth dung would be very pungent. And I can tell you, it certainly is, even to the nostrils of a human being. But what extraordinary quirk of evolution led sloths down into their dim and silent alley? Well, raw leaves, no matter what salad enthusiasts may tell you, are remarkably indigestible. Cows, deer, and antelope deal with that, as everyone knows, by giving a mouthful a good chew, sending it down to the stomach, letting it stew there for a bit, and then bringing it back up again as cud and chewing it a second time. And even after all that, the bulk of the meal, the cellulose, is so resistant to the digestive juices that it has no nutritive value and has to be ejected. But out on the plains, an animal is very visible and an obvious target for meat-eaters like lions. So plant-eaters have to be either formidably, almost invincibly big, like buffalo or elephant, or become such good runners that they can outpace most hunters. But up in the trees and well camouflaged, an animal can chew away and take all the time it wants to digest its meals. If that enables you to cope with particularly indigestible leaves that no one else wants, then you needn't remain particularly active or strong or swift, and you can take all the time you like to digest them. In short, you become slothful. There may be a moral somewhere in all this, but I confess I'm not sure what it is. I like flowers to have a certain modesty. Shrinking violets are more to my taste.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.